يا حامل القرآن قد خصك الرحمن بالفضل والتيجان والروح والريحان. يا حامل القرآن قد خصك الرحمن بالفضل والتيجان والروح والريحان. يا دائم الترتيل للذكر والتنزيل بشراك يوم رحيل ستفوز بالغفران. يا قارئ الآيات في الجمع والخلوات تزهو بك السماوات.
Try to study a short study of one aspect of this great book that we have, which is the miraculous Quran. And we'll try to go over the aspects of why the Quran is considered a miracle. When we Muslims speak of the miracles of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we first thing we say, well, our biggest miracle is Al-Quran. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did have miracles that were physical miracles, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala documented that even He split the moon for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But yet, when we claim a prophet, we claim a miracle as Muslims, we speak of Al-Quran. So inshallah we will try in this session, to start in this session, and through the month of Ramadan we will have inshallah three sessions to study the miracle of the Quran. The Quran Kareem, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, is an intercession for us on the Day of Judgment. That on the Day of Judgment, the Quran and the Siyam will come and intercede for us before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Siyam will say, I prevented him or her from their food and drinks, and let me intercede for them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would accept that intercession. And Al-Quran would come and would say, I prevented them from sleeping at night as they were reading the Quran, reciting the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would accept this intercession. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke of this Quran and called it huda, guidance in the book. فَمَنِ اتَّبَعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا يَضِلِّ وَلَا يَشْقَى. Those who follow this guidance, they will not go astray and they will not be distressed. They will always be in quietude and a state of comfort. In this dunya with the iman, and in the akhirah with the reward, and with the pleasure with meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said of this Quran on the authority of Ali radiallahu anhu, and this hadith is narrated in Ad-Durrani wa Nisa'i, he said, Kitabullahi fihi naba'u ma qablakum. There are the news, the history of those before you. وَخَبَرُوا مَا بَعْدَكُمْ. And the news for what is to come. There's a lot of prophecies in this Quran. We have seen some of it. And the Sahaba have seen some of it. Like what the beginning of Surah Ar-Rum, when the Roman were defeated by the Persians, and the Quran comes few years earlier to predict the victory of the Romans, the Byzantine, over the Persian. غُلِبَتِ الرُّومُ فِي أَدْنَى الْأَرْضِ وَهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ غَلَبِهِمْ سَيَغْلِبُونَ فِي بِضْعِ سِنِينَ. And that happened. But there are prophecies and predictions that inshallah we know it would be realized as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised. هُوَ الْفَصْلُ لَيْسَ بِالْهَزْلِ. It is serious. There is no joke about it, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. مَنْ تَرَكَهُ مِنْ جَبَّارٍ قَسَمَهُ اللَّهُ. A person of might and power and transgression, if they leave this Quran behind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will wipe them out. وَمَنْ اِبْتَغَى الْهُدَى فِي غَيْرِهِ أَضَلَّهُ اللَّهُ. And those who see guidance in something else, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let them be led astray. فَهُوَ حَبْلُ اللَّهِ الْمَتِينَ. It is indeed the strong rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهُوَ الذِّكْرُ الْحَكِيمُ. And it is the mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is filled with wisdom. وَهُوَ الصِّرَاطُ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ. And it is indeed the straight path. وهو الذي لا تزيغ به الأهواء. That it is the one that does not follow the desire. And when the person follows the book, then the caprice does not take hold of that person. ولا تلتبس به الألسنة. And there is no confusion when the tongues read the Quran. ولا يشبع منه العلماء. And the scholars are never satiated with the knowledge that is in this book. ولا يخلق عن كثرة الرد. And it doesn't get old. As much as you repeat it, as many times as you read it, it never gets old. And Muslims have been reading this Quran for 1400 and more than 30 years, and it will never get old. ولا تنقضي عجائبه. Its miracles will never cease. وهو الذي لم ينتهي الجن إن سمعته أن قالوا إنا سمعنا قرآنا عجبا. Even the jinn, and this is the hadith, when they heard this Quran, they said, we have heard a wondrous Quran, wondrous mention. من قال به صدق. Those who speak of the Quran, they are saying the truth. ومن حكم به عدل. And those who rule by the Quran, they are ruling with justice. ومن عمل به أجر. And those who work with it, then they will get the reward from Allah سبحانه وتعالى. ومن دعا إليه هدي إلى صراط مستقيم أو هدى إلى صراط مستقيم. And those who call to its way, then they are calling to the right path. This is the book. This is the miracle. So what aspects of miracles we will be studying in this book and this Quran inshallah? First, what is a miracle? How do we define something as a miracle? First, as the scholar said, it is an extraordinary event. It's an event that breaks the habitual environment that we live in. And then it has to come from a divine source. To see a shuttle tunneling through the skies, it's an extraordinary event, but it's not a divine event, it's a man-made event, thus it's not a miracle. It may be a miracle of science and etc. But to qualify in the religion as a miracle, it has to come from the divine source of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It cannot be replicated. It cannot be replicated by humans. The roots of the word mu'jiza, miracle in Arabic means mu'jiza. And the roots of the word is ajaza, is could not do. Something that you cannot do, something that is beyond your reach, beyond your doing. And that is the root of the word mu'jiza. And that means no one can replicate this miracle. And we will see that the characteristic of the Quran Kareem will apply to all the characteristic of the word mu'jiza. It has to be challenging. Mu'jiza doesn't come for showing. It's not for entertainment. It challenges people. It shows them, here's what Allah can do. Worship Him. Obey Him. You cannot do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing. It's a show of power. And it has to dare people. And the other thing, it comes after the prophecy. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had dreams that would come true, had many things that were right before the birth. They are called irhasat. They're called pre-drome of the message. They are not called mu'jiza until after the birth. These are the conditions of something to be called mu'jiza. So is this our Quran a mu'jiza? The other thing that the mu'jiza comes for, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends His messenger and He sends a miracle, He sends the miracle designed to challenge these people in something they excelled at. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Musa alayhi salam with miracles, when he would throw his staff and it turns into snake, when he puts his hand into his armpit and it comes out white, when he hits the sea with his staff and it breaks down into two, these are miracles just like magic, but they're much more than magic. And who did Musa challenge this miracle? He challenged Fir'aun. Well, what is the strength of Fir'aun? As-Sahara, the magicians. That was the thing that the pharaohs excelled at. The old ancient Egypt was excelled in sorcery and magic. And that's why when Fir'aun wanted to challenge Musa, he said, call the magicians, call the sorcerers. And that's why we see the miracles of Musa came appropriate for his time and for the atmosphere around him at that time. Well, Isa alayhi salam came to the Jews. The Jews had mastery in the arts of medicine. The art of healing, and they would heal the diseases. And Isa came to heal diseases that are really incurable, like vitiligo, like blindness. Like he would wipe on the eyes of the blind and they will see. And he even would call on the dead and they will come to him. He cannot cure death. Any physician knows that you cannot cure death. But Isa came to show the healing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is miraculous. And that was the miracle of Isa alayhi salam. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, the Arabs at that time excelled in their language. Their language was their art, was their daily living. In the Arab world at that time, you can take a tribe to a state of honor with a poem, and you can put people down with a poem, and it made a lot of difference. And the words in Arabia made their daily living worth it. And even they would take good poems and they would hang it on the Kaaba. They would take a special poem and they would hang those poems on the Kaaba, and they call it al-mu'allaqat, meaning the ones that are hanged. So to take these poems and to make it sacred by putting it in the holiest place for Arabs and holiest place for Muslims today. And we know what these words meant to these people. And that's why when they heard the Quran, they knew. They immediately realized the miracle of the Quran. When Khalid ibn Uqba, and in another narration, Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira sat with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited one verse. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ يَعِظُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. He mentioned that verse, and the man came out of the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, "Inna li qawlihi la halawa, wa inna alayhi la talawa, wa inna a'lahu la muthmir, wa inna asfalahu la mughdiq, wa innahu ya'lu wa la yu'la alayhi, wa ma huwa bi qawli al-bashar." When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Khalid ibn Utbah, or in another narration, Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enjoins justice and doing good. وَإِتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى, and to connect with your kinship. وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ, and he prevents and prohibits the fahsha, the fornication, the munkar, the bad deeds, and the baghi, and the transgression. يَعِذُكُمْ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advise you and admonish you. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ, as you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These words, when they're mentioned by the Quranic linguistic, stunned this man who was very well versed in the Arabic literature. And when he came out, he said, these are not the words of a human being. They had immediate realization that these words cannot come from a human. When Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anh, when he was going to kill the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he entered the house of his sister and beat her because she was a Muslim, and then he holds a page that says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Taha, ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى إلا تذكرة لمن يخشى تنزيلا من رب تنزيلا من تنزيلا ممن خلق السماوات والأرض العلى الرحمن على العرش استوى. And he read those verses and his heart turned. And his heart turned into Islam, and he became a Muslim just by listening to the words. This is the miracle that we will try to study and to understand. The Quran as a miracle is very much different from the miracle of other prophets. When Musa alayhi salam split the sea open, only the people that were there and then could realize the magnitude of that miracle. When they saw the Red Sea splitting apart, when Isa alayhi salam called upon the dead and they came walking to him, only the people that were watching could feel the true magnitude of it. But the miracle of the Quran is not limited by time, and it's not limited by place. And we can sense that miracle today, 1,420 years, 1,315 years after the passing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just like the Sahaba could feel the miracle of the Quran when it was revealed to them. The Quran combines a message and a miracle at the same time. And that is one of the, no other prophet was given such honor, that his own message, the embodiment of the message of the Prophet ﷺ, is this book, and it is his miracle at the same time. And the miracle of the Qur'an extends beyond just the linguistic part. But inshallah, we will be studying the language of the Qur'an tonight, and we will study other aspects of this miracle, inshallah, in other sessions. We said one of the aspects of the Qur'an, that it, of any miracle, that it has to come from a divine source. And that has been challenged by many people that wanted to put doubts in the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Could not have come, this Qur'an could not have been scripted by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his own book in al-Qur'an, he says why it could not be from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number one, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was illiterate. This was a known fact in Quraysh. It was a known fact in history that he could not read, he could not write. Even when he was writing the Sulh of Al-Hudaybiyah, and he wanted to wipe out the word of Rasulullah, and Ali did not want to wipe it out, the Prophet could not, he said, just show me where it is, and he wiped it out. He could not read. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who taught humanity, was an illiterate man. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Ankabut says, in verse 49, وَمَا كُنْتَ تَتْلُو مِنْ قَبْلِهِ مِنْ كِتَابٍ وَلَا تَخُطُّهُ بِيَمِينِكَ إِذَا لَرْتَابَ الْمُبْطِلُونَ. And you were not able to recite a book before this book came, nor were you able to transcribe it with your right hands. In fact, in that case indeed, would the talkers of vanities have doubted. Means there is no doubt. How could he learn this? How could he come with this eloquence, with this miracle that is standing the test of time? The other thing is, it could not have been scripted by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Prophet had no control over the revelation. And the example of that is what happened when the calamity hit the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when his own beloved wife Aisha was accused with falsehood, and the one famous event of al-ifk, of the falsehood. The Prophet was for 1 month waiting for a word from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put this straight, and nothing happened. For a whole month, the house of the Prophet was shaken with this calamity. And then until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted, the revelation in Surah An-Nur came. So the Qur'an came not to the schedule to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He could have, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the one who was writing the Qur'an, he would have just resolved the whole issue the second day. But it's a whole month Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested his Prophet. Another thing is, the Qur'an came in a disagreement in some of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam actions. One of the very well known events, when Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, the blind man, came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was concerned in spreading the da'wah, and the blind man was asking the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for knowledge, and then this man was keep repeating and arguing and urging the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam frowned, and a revelation came to criticize the position of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى أَوْ يَذَّكَّرُ فَتَنْفَعَهُ الذِّكْرَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the Prophet frowned and turned away because there came him a blind man interrupting. But what could tell you but the perchance he might grow in spiritual understanding, or that he may receive admonition and the teaching might benefit him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a critique for his Prophet in that event. Another event, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and there is multiple aspects of this story, but Surah At-Tahrim is very clear, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala disagrees with the Prophet's decision of making something haram which is halal. He said, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ لِمَ تُحَرِّمُ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكَ تَبْتَغِي مَرْضَاتَ أَزْوَاجِكَ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. O Prophet, why do you hold to be forbidden with which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made lawful to you? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala disagreed with his Prophet. A very famous event is after Badr, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took the prisoners of war in Badr and he let them free and he gave ransom or let them teach people how to read and write and he sent them free, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala disagreed with that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran said, ما كان لنبي أن يكون له أسرى حتى يثخن في الأرض تريدون عرض الحياة الدنيا تريدون عرض الدنيا والله يريد الآخرة والله عزيز حكيم. It is not fitting for a prophet that he should have prisoners of war until he has thoroughly subdued the land. And this was when Umar described the state that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I walked into the situation and I saw the tears on the face of the Prophet and I saw him and Abu Bakr weeping because it was their opinion that those prisoners should be let free. So how could this book be scripted by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and had criticism to some of the position that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has done? Challenging. Is this miracle a challenging miracle? Or if you open the book and you read the Fatiha and you go on into Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. It is indeed the book, there is no doubt about it. It challenges from the very first pages of this book. People, there is no doubt, this is the book from Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged humanity and the jinn and the parallel world of the jinn that live with us. He said, قُلْ لَئِنْ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنْسُ وَالْجِنُّ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا. He said, indeed, of the whole mankind and the jinn were to gather together to produce the like of this Quran, they could not produce the like thereof, even if they backed up each other with help and support. And the challenge maybe was too much, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it less. He said, أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَى قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِعَشْرِ سُوَرٍ مُفْتَرَيَاتٍ عَشْرِ سُوَرٍ مُفْتَرَيَاتٍ مِثْلِهِ وَادْعُوا مَنْ عَشْرِ سُوَرٍ مِثْلِهِ مُفْتَرَيَاتٍ وَادْعُوا مَنْ اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَكُمْ فَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا أُنْزِلَ بِعِلْمِ اللَّهِ وَأَنَّ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ أَنَّ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, so they may say he forged it. Say, bring you then 10 surahs forged. We accept, just bring me 10 surahs that are forged. And Allah would accept it, like unto it, and call to your aid whomever you can, other than Allah, if you speak the truth, but you can't. And if then they, with your false gods, answer not your call, know you that this revelation is sent down with the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there is no God but He. Will you then even submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And if that challenge was too much, 10 surah they could not do, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it less of a challenge. He said, أَنْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَى قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ وَالْأَبْتَرِ. He said, bring one surah, just one surah. مِنْ مِئْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِثْلِهِ وَادْعُوا مَنْ اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Or do they say he forged it? Say, bring then a surah like unto it and call whoever you want beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you do speak the truth. And that was a challenge to the kuffar of Mecca in Surah Yunus, which is a Makki surah. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Medina, there were people of knowledge, there were the Jews who claimed the knowledge of the book, and Allah repeated the challenge in a Madani surah, in Surah Al-Baqarah. He said, وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْدٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِنْ مِثْلِهِ وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. A challenge in Mecca and a challenge in Al-Medina. And he said, bring one surah, no matter how short it is. Why this challenge still stands this test of time? Many people tried. Musaylam al-Kadhab tried. And many people today try. You will see on the internet some imitation. But how do we know that this cannot be like the Quran? If we know the miraculous aspects of our book. If we know why is this Quran is so tight. كِتَابٌ أُحْكِمَتْ آيَاتُهُ. His verses is so tied together, you cannot replace one letter in the Quran. And we will see why inshallah. So the language of the Quran, the linguistic aspect of this miracle is what we inshallah try to study tonight and what is left in our time. The Arabic language is without a doubt the richest vocabulary known to human being. This is the science of linguistic. These are not a bias of Muslims or a bias of an Arab. This is what the scientists of linguistics say. This is the richest vocabulary. And it is one of the most flexible languages known to man. From one root in Arabic, you can take 40 different words. Each of them has a different meaning. 40 different words out of one root, which is usually 3 letters in Arabic, or 4 letters in rare occasions. And of that, if you compare that to English, the roots, you can take a root of English and the maximum you can derive out of that is 12 words. In Arabic you can get 40. And it's a poetic language. The art mastered by the Kuffar and the Arabs before Islam. And we said like they hung their poems on the Kaaba. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described His book as the book that was descended with this language that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for His religion, chose for His book, and He chose for the people in Al-Jannah inshaAllah. And inshaAllah, whether we speak fluent Arabic or not, in Al-Jannah we will. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينَ عَلَى قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنذِرِينَ بِلِسَانٍ عَرَبِيٍ مُبِينٍ. He said, it is indeed was descended to your heart and mind that you may admonish them in the perspicuous Arabic tongue. And in more than 9 position in the 9 places in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 9 times describing the Quran as the Arabic book. إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ وَكَذَلِكَ أَنزَلْنَاهُ حُكْمًا عَرَبِيًّا وَكَذَلِكَ أَنزَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا وَصَرَّفْنَا فِيهِ مِنَ الْوَعِيدِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا غَيْرَ ذِي عِوَجٍ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ كِتَابٌ فُصِّلَتْ آيَاتُهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لِقَوْمٍ يَعْلَمُونَ إِنَّا جَعَلْنَاهُ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ قُرْآنًا عَرَبِيًّا لِتُنذِرَ أُمَّ الْقُرَى وَمَنْ حَوْلَهَا وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ مُصَدِّقٌ لِسَانًا عَرَبِيًّا لِيُنذِرَ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا وَبُشْرَى لِلْمُحْسِنِينَ. The Arabic language is the language of the Quran, and we will see why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshallah will try to shed some light about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for His book. Number one, in this Quran there is no word that can replace another word. There is a good incidence in history where Al-Asma'i, one of the great scholars of the language, Al-Asma'i in Arabic is more than Shakespeare in English. He is the man of the language. And one time he was reciting this ayah that came from Surah Al-Ma'idah. He said, وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَقْطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا جَزَاءً بِمَا كَسَبَا نَكَالًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ is the way he finished it. And a man who is illiterate, who is an Arab, a nomad Arab, was sitting there, and he said, who said this? And Al-Asma'i said, Allah. And he said, this cannot be the words of Allah. Because Al-Asma'i finished this ayah by saying, اللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. And the people started beating this nomad, and they said, how would you dare challenge Al-Asma'i? And he said, I can, because that does not sound right. And Al-Asma'i said, don't beat him, just bring him Surah Al-Ma'idah and let him read it. And then when they read Surah Al-Ma'idah, this nomad was right. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَقْطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا جَزَاءً بِمَا كَسَبَا نَكَالًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. And they said, the man, how did you know that Al-Asma'i was reciting it wrong? And he said, because he said غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, all forgiving, all merciful. But the ayah means punishment for those who steal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said نَكَالًا, severe punishment, and you tell me غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. It is not a position of مَغْفِرَة, it is position of عِزَّة and حِكْمَة. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said it is عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. And then when we look at the Qur'an, let's look at these two verses. One of them in Surah As-Saffat, the other one in Surah Yusuf. Two of them about prophets telling the people that we saw a dream. Yusuf said, قَالَ إِذْ قَالَ يُوسُفُ لِأَبِيهِ يَا أَبَتِ إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَحَدَ عَشَرَ كَوْكَبًا. And Ibrahim said, قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ. Can we take إِنِّي أَرَى and replace it with إِنِّي رَأَيْتَ in either verse? And why not? Think about that for a minute while I read the translation. Ibrahim said, "Oh my son, I see in vision that I offered thee in sacrifice, that I offered thee in sacrifice. I see. Inni ara. Inni ara." It's a present tense. And then Yusuf said to his father, "Oh my father, I did see 11 stars and the sun and the moon." What is the difference? And can we say, can we replace it? Can anyone replace that? The answer is no, because it tells the exact thing that happened to Yusuf. Yusuf, in one time in his dream, he saw the 11 stars, he saw the planets kneeling down to him, and he saw the sun and the moon. Ibrahim, he was repeatedly watching the same dream over and over and over again. And the first time he would think, it is not true. It is abghath wa ahlam. He cannot be slaughtering his own son. But it kept happening and happening and happening. And this word is what tells us that that was the case. Inni ara is different from inni ra'ayt. And if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is paying attention to these details, then it is absolutely impossible. And we will see how that is true. The other thing, there is that internal music in the Qur'an. This rhyming in the Qur'an, the beauty of it. You don't need to understand one word when you listen to a good reciter like our brothers here, Shaykh Ilahi and Shaykh Mas'ud, when they say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wal-shamsi wa-duhaha, wal-qamari idha talaha, wal-nahari idha jallaha, wal-layli idha yaghshaha, والسماءِ وما بناها والأرضِ وما طحاها ونفسٍ وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها. And to the end of these verses, just that music that seeps through your soul. And not only that, it comes with a meaning. If you look at Surah Abasa wa Tawalla, now the first part of these verses, and you don't need to know a word of Arabic, of also you to really know the Quran al-Kareem, it is a duty to learn Arabic. But you can just listen to the rhythm. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about the plentiful bounties that He gave mankind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَلْيَنْظُرِ الْإِنسَانُ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِهِ أَنَّا صَبَبْنَا الْمَاءَ صَبَّا ثُمَّ شَقَقْنَا الْأَرْضَ شَقَّا فَأَنْبَتْنَا فِيهَا حَبَّا وَعِنَبًا وَقَضْبًا وَزَيْتُونًا وَنَخْلًا وَحَدَائِقَ غُلْبًا وَفَاكِهَةً وَأَبًّا مَتَاعًا لَكُمْ وَلِأَنْعَامِكُمْ. You see the stretch of the sound? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this is how I stretched the bounties for you, limitless. All these are bounties that Allah stretched for us. And then all of a sudden, we were reciting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَفَاكِهَةً وَأَبَّا مَتَاعًا لَكُمْ وَلِأَنْعَامِكُمْ فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الصَّاخَّةِ. An event happened. You just feel it in the words. Something happened, everything stops. And that is the day of judgment. فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الصَّاخَّةِ يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِيهِ. Anxiety, you feel the anxiety of the day of judgment just for the rhythm of the words. This is a miracle of the Qur'an. And then when he speaks of those who are happy, listen to the letters, just the soft letters that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses. وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ مُسْفِرَةٌ ضَاحِكَةٌ مُسْتَبْشِرَةٌ. These are the happy faces of the believers. And then listen to the other part, the ones that are not happy, the unbelievers. وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَلَيْهَا غَبَرَةٌ تَرْحَقُهَا قَتَرَةٌ. See the letters, the harsh letters, because it describes you the harshnesses of those voices, of those faces. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَفَرَةُ الْفَجَرَةُ. This is the internal music of the Qur'an. And many people that just listening to the recitation, they feel their heart shake with the Qur'an. Just get our attention to one very important thing as we speak of these miraculous aspects of the Qur'an. We have to understand that the Qur'an is everlasting miracle, And many aspects that we consider miraculous in the 21st century were not even known in the 19th or 18th century or the centuries before. And that is actually one of the aspects of the miracle of the Quran, is in every generation, in every age, and in every country, it has a miraculous aspect. And we'll try to shed the light on some of it. So don't go home with the thoughts that this is it, and well, now we know about all the aspects of the miracle of the Quran, because it will never happen. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith that we recited last session, he said, لَا تَنْقَضِي عَجَائِبُ. His miracles, the miracles of the Quran, its miracles will never cease. It's going to keep on coming and coming and coming. And we spoke last time, before a quick review for the brothers and sisters that were not with us, we spoke of the miracle of the Quran, said, for anything to be a miracle, mu'jiza, it has to be an extraordinary event, something that doesn't happen usually. It has to come from a divine source, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It cannot be replicated by humans. The source of the word, the roots of the word mu'jiza is ajaza. It means cannot do, something that no human is able to do. And it has to challenge. The whole purpose of a mu'jiza is a challenge. It's a daring event to challenge people. Is this is what Allah can do. Show me what your gods or what you can do. And then it comes usually after the beginning of the prophecy. And we said, come to challenge people in matter that they have mastered. And one of the aspects of the miracle of the Quran, that it came to challenge the Arab tribes and their language, was in that what they take pride, and they have a lot of respect to the linguistic abilities of people, where they actually got to hang some of their poems on the Kaaba, and they called those poems al-mu'allaqat. And to prove, went over some of the evidence and the proof that this is not scripted, cannot be scripted. We know as Muslims that this could not be scripted, and it's not scripted by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And somebody may say, why are we saying these things over and over again and bring proof to people who are actually believers? And the example of that, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the best similitude, when Ibrahim asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, رَبِّ أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى قَالَ أَوَلَمْ تُؤْمِنْ قَالَ بَلَى وَلَكِنْ لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, show me how you revive the death. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, didn't you believe that I can do that? He said, yes, but let my heart settle. Let my heart settle down with itma'nan. And that's why we always have to remember and remind ourselves. So this could not be scripted, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was illiterate. He could not write or read. He had no source of knowledge to get all these beautiful, all these authenticated stories of those people before us, and to get all this ceaseless knowledge. وَمَا كُنْتَ تَتْلُو مِنْ قَبْلِهِ مِنْ كِتَابٍ وَلَا تَخُطُّهُ بِيَمِينِكِ إِذَا لَرْتَابَ الْمُبْطِلُونَ. And the Quran did not come according to the request or the needs of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We spoke of the event of al-ifk, the falsehood. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in dire need for one ayah to just settle things in his house, and his wife has been accused of an utmost crime, and she is innocent, and waiting for just the revelation to come, and waited a whole month, because Quran comes according to the schedule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not according to the schedule of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then it came to critique the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of actions many times, like in Surah Abbas, Abasa wa tawalla and ja'ahu al-a'ma. And we said another example of that, Surah Al-Tahrim, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ لِمَ تُحَرِّمُ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكَ تَبْتَغِي مَرْضَاتَ أَزْوَاجِكَ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. And a third proof is in the verses of Al-Anfal after Ghazwat Badr. مَا كَانَ لِنَبِيٍّ أَن يَكُونَ لَهُ أَسْرَى حَتَّى يُثْخِنَ فِي الْأَرْضِ تُرِيدُونَ عَرَضَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَاللَّهُ يُرِيدُ الْآخِرَةَ وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. And then it was a challenging miracle. You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged the ins, the humans, and the jinn to bring the Quran, to bring something like the Quran. And they could not. Then the challenge went down to only 10 surah. Only 10 surah, muftarayat, forged surah. Bring any forged surah like the Quran, like the strength of the Quran, and it could not happen. Then the challenge went down to one surah. Bring one surah like the shortest surah, إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِيَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرُ. Bring one surah. that has the solidarity and has the authenticity of the Quran. And it could not happen and this challenge was in Surah Yunus, which is a Makki surah. The challenge was again in Surah Al-Baqarah, which is a Madani surah, when the Muslims interacted with the people of the book that had the knowledge of before. So the challenge remained. وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْدٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَى عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِنْ مِثْلِهِ وَادْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about this Quran, Alif Lam Ra, كِتَابٌ أُحْكِمَتْ آيَاتُهُ ثُمَّ فُصِّلَتْ مِنْ لَدُنْ حَكِيمٍ خَبِيرٍ. These verses have been perfected and held tied together by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Al-Hakim Al-Khabir. The language of the Quran is what we started with. Inshallah, we'll continue this aspect and try to finish some of it tonight. And this is the Arabic language, is chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the language of the people of Al-Jannah. It is the richest language in vocabulary. From the Arabic one root in the Arabic language, you can derive 40 words. If you compare that to English, you can derive only 12. And that tells you about the richness of this language. And it's a poetic language, and we saw that in some examples last session. We got to the point of explaining some of the miraculous aspect of the linguistic aspect of the miracle of the Quran. And one of these things is the tight, composed Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كِتَابٌ أُحْكِمَتْ آيَاتُهُ. You cannot really change one letter in this Quran and keep the integrity intact. You cannot keep it intact. And we saw how each word serves a particular purpose. Like we brought two examples. One of them when Ibrahim said about a dream that he saw to his son when he saw that he was slaughtering Ismail alayhi salam. He said, قَالَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكْ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا سَرَى. And when Yusuf saw a dream, he said to his father, يَا أَبَتِ إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَحَدَ عَشَرَ كَوْكَبًا. Can we replace these words and the meaning stay the same? Can Ibrahim say, يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكْ. And can Yusuf said, يَا أَبَتِ إِنِّي أَرَى أَحَدَ عَشَرَ كَوْكَبًا. The meaning will change. Why is that? Because the dream that Ibrahim saw kept repeating itself. He kept saying it over and over and over again. The same message is coming to him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to describe that, he used inni ara. It's I see, it's a present, it's continuous, something that is happening again. Simple present, if you will, if you want to do a parallel to English. But Yusuf saw that dream once, and that's why he saw, I did see 11 stars. إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَحَدَ عَشْرَ كَوْكَبًا. And you cannot replace this for that and keep the meaning the same. We spoke of the rhythm of the Qur'an. How the rhythm, not only when we hear a Qur'an recited from one of the Qur'a, one of the reciters of the Qur'an, we hear the beauty of it, our hearts react with it. And sometimes even if we don't understand the meaning of the word, our hearts still react to it. There is that rhythm, internal rhythm of the Qur'an that is miraculous, it's unbelievable. Listen to these verses. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم فلينظر الإنسان إلى طعامه أنا صببنا الماء صبا ثم شققنا الأرض شقا فأنبتنا فيها حبا وعنبا وقضبا وزيتونا ونخلا وحدائق غلبا وفاكهة وأبا متاعا لكم ولأنعامكم فإذا جاءت الصاخة يوم يفر المرء من أخيه وأمه وأبيه وصاحبته وبنيه لكل امرئ منهم يومئذ شأن يغنيه وجوه يومئذ مسفرة ضاحكة مستبشرة ووجوه يومئذ عليها غبرة ترهقها قترة أولئك هم الكفرة الفجرة. And I did put translation there for a purpose. You saw the first whole section when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about spending the bounties on it, expanding life for us, giving us more. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the mad. فَإِنَّا صَبَبْنَا الْمَاءَ صَبَّا ثُمَّ شَقَقْنَا الْأَرْضَ شَقَّا
فأنبتنا فيها حبا.
Allah has given us more expanding, and you see the rhythm is going to show us that. And then when the day of judgment came, you hear sudden stop, everything ceased. فإذا جاءت الصاخة.
Six motions mad, obligatory.
Right, Chef?
Six motion mad, you have to do it that way. Everything stops, all ceases. You hear that in the rhythm of the Quran. And then you hear the anxiety of the day of judgment.
يوم يفر المرء من أخيه وأمه وأبيه.
Everybody's running around. You hear that anxiety, you feel that. And then when you hear the words that are describing the faces of the believers, you hear the smooth letters.
وجوه يومئذ مسفرة مسفرة.
And when you listen to the faces of the unbelievers, Allah make us of the believers,
وجوه يومئذ عليها غبرة ترهقها قترة.
Difficult words, difficult letters come, because that's the state they are in. They are in a very difficult state. And that internal rhythm is miraculous. And there is no book that mimics and come close to even be like the rhythm of the Quran. The other thing is, some of the words have the pronunciation of it, have the feeling, the same thing. Like when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَا لَكُمْ إِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ انْفِرُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ اثَّاقَلْتُمْ إِلَى الْأَرْضِ.
اثَّاقَلْتُمْ, heavy. And it means that, all you who believe, what is the matter with you that when you are asked to go forth in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you cling heavily to earth? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لم يقل تثاقلتم, said اثاقلتم. And that is some aspect of the miracle of the Quran. The other thing is, each letter has a very important purpose. Look at these two verses. One of them came in Luqman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said,
يَا بُنَيَّ أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ يَا بُنَيَّ أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ وَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَانْهَى عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ إِنَّ ذَلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ.
O son, establish regular prayer, enjoin what is just and forbid what is wrong, and bear with patience. أَصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ. Constancy, whatever afflicts you, for this is firmness of purpose, resolution in the conducts of affairs.
إِنَّ ذَلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ.
You read the second verse,
وَلِمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ إِنَّ ذَلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ.
So first one is مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ, and the second one is لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. Why is that? What is the difference? Listen to the next ayah. But indeed, if any show patience and forgive, that would truly, lemin is for emphasis, that means truly, indeed, certainly, be an exercise of firmness of purpose, resolution, and the conduct of affair. Why a lamb came here and it did not come there? Because the act in the first ayah is an act of patience. And patience on a musibah. Musibah is afflicted, it happens, things that happen. You are afflicted by the musibah of death, afflicted by musibah of disease, afflicted by an earthquake, afflicted by famine, general musibah. So if we are patients, this is indeed min azmi al-umur. It is of the firmness of purpose and of the resolution. But when there are forgiveness involved, وَلِمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ, if somebody actually caused this disaster to happen, and then you forgive, then that takes a lot more strength, a lot more resolution, and a lot more firmness. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said,
وَلِمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ فَإِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ.
Another example. Look at these two verses. First verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said,
قُلْ تَعَالَوْا أَتْلُ مَا حَرَّمَ رَبُّكُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ أَلَّا تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ شَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ مِنْ إِمْلَاقٍ نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكُمْ وَإِيَّاهُمْ وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الْفَوَاحِشَ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنْ إِلَى آخر الآية.
The second verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said,
وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ خَشْيَةَ إِمْلَاقٍ نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُهُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ إِنَّ قَتْلَهُمْ كَانَ خِطْئًا كَبِيرًا.
Two verses speak of the same thing, of killing children because of poverty. But there is subtle differences there. Listen to the first verse. First verse said, kill not your children on a plea of poverty. When you are hit with poverty, do not kill your children. لا تقتلوا أولادكم من إملاق. The state of poverty is there. People are poor. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, do not kill them. We provide sustenance for you and for them. And you came before them. But when you look at the next one, لا تقتلوا أولادكم خشية إملاق. Do not kill your children for fear of poverty. We shall provide sustenance for them as well as you. Them came before you. Why is that? Why in the first verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we will provide for you and we'll provide for them. And in the second verse Allah said, we will provide for them and we will provide for you. Because in the first verse, it's the state of poverty is there. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reassuring people who are in the state of poverty, we will give you sustenance. And we will also give your children sustenance. So don't kill them from this state. The second one is people fearing if they have more children, then they will go into a state of poverty. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, don't kill these children. The sustenance will come with them. We will send the sustenance to their children like we are sending it to you. نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُهُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ. Then we will give them their sustenance even before they come. And see the delicate. And then people say, the author of the Quran is Awul Iyadu Billah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then look at Surah Al-Kahf. Look at, we know, all learned about the story of the learned man, the knowledgeable person, Al-Khadr alayhi salam, that had a meeting, and we know the story with Musa alayhi salam. And what, look at the conversation and the letters that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the verbs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used to tell this conversation. First he said, قَالَ إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعْيَ صَبْرًا. You cannot be patient, you cannot endure, you cannot persevere with me. The Khadr is telling us, Musa alayhi salam. And تَسْتَطِيعَ mean you cannot, you will not be able to. إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعْيَ صَبْرًا. And then the next time when Musa objected to the first action, he said, أَلَمْ أَقُلْ إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعْيَ صَبْرًا. Didn't I say, that you cannot be patient with me, you cannot persevere. And then when he objected the second time, then he said, قَالَ أَلَمْ أَلَقُلْ أَقُلْ لَكَ إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعْيَ صَبْرًا. Didn't I say to you, didn't I tell you? So it got a little bit more firm with this, just two letters, لَكَ إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعْيَ صَبْرًا. But look at تَسْتَطِيعَ here, and then when he started explaining to him, the third time he said, هَذَا فِرَاقُ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنِكَ. سَأُنَبِّئُكَ بِتَأْوِيلِ مَا لَمْ تَسْتَطِعْ عَلَيْهِ صَبْرًا. تَسْتَطِعْ became تَسْتَطِعْ. And then when he explained everything, he said, ذَلِكَ تَأْوِيلُ مَا لَمْ تَسْطِعْ عَلَيْهِ صَبْرًا. Three words, same meaning. Very same meaning, but why the difference in the use of the verb? تَسْتَطِعْ, تَسْتَطِعْ, and تَسْطِعْ. Because the first word is difficult. تَسْتَطِعْ, right? The second one is easier, تَسْتَطِعْ. And the third one is the easiest, تَسْطِعْ. Because when Musa was seeing all these mysteries, it was very difficult for him to be patient. Very difficult to really not stay silent and not tell him, why didn't you kill that boy, that innocent boy? It's very hard not to keep, to hold back. So the word to describe that action came, تَسْتَطِعْ. He said, you will not be able to do that. إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِعْ. But then when he was going about to explain to him, things were getting a little easy. Number one, there are no more tests. You're not going to have to endure more. So things have come easier, and I'm going to explain to you. So he said, لَمْ تَسْتَطَعَ. تَسْتَطَعَ. It's really easier than what you thought. And then when he explained everything, and things became very clear, and it's so easy now to understand, the verb came very, very easy. مَا لَمْ تَسْطَعَ عَلَيْهِ صَبْرًا. So look at that. Look at this choice of letters and words. And look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ability and miracle of the Qur'an. The other thing is the Qur'an can bring meanings of the words by using repeated syllables. The repeated syllables can mean repeated action, like the verb zalzala. Zalzala, the zal means air earthquake, and zalzala means shaking the earth. But zalzal, zalzal, the same syllable is repeated twice, meaning shaking over and over again. And the other one is عَادٌ وَأَمَّ عَادٌ فَأُهْرِكُوا بِرِيحٍ صَرْصَرٍ. صَرْصَرٍ, you keep pounding them, pounding them, pounding them. عاتية. And you see the verb, there are many verbs in Arabic and many descriptions of the wind, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses this one that has repeated syllables to let you know that this is a repeated action. And then al-waswas, the shaitan that whispers in the hearts of people, alladhi yuwaswisu, waswas. He does it over and over and over again, and he will never let you go. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have said, alladhi yahmisu fi suduri nas, the one that whispers in the hearts of people. But he said, yuwaswisu. You know how persistent a shaitan is just by using that one verb. And then sometimes to put emphasis on one letter in the verb, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you that you do this action repeatedly. Like the tawaf, the going around the Kaaba, or going between al-Safa and al-Marwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ الصَّفَى وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ فَمَنْ حَجَّ الْبَيْتَ وَاعْتَمَرْ فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِ أَنْ يَطَّوَّفَ بِهِمَا. Not أَنْ يَطُوفَ بِهِمَا, أَنْ يَطَّوَّف, meaning that you have to do it more than once. Had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَنْ يَطُوفَ بِهِمَا, then one time would be enough. But يَطَّوَّف, mean you have to do it repeatedly. And when Yusuf alayhi salam walked into that room filled with the women and they had knives in their hand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described that scene, and he said, فَلَمَّا رَأَيْنَهُ أَكْبَرْنَهُ وَقَطَّعْنَا أَيْدِيَهُنْ. Not قَطَعْنَا, the قَطَعْنَا and قَطَعْنَا. قَطَعْنَا, they cut their fingers once. But they were so stunned with the handsomeness of Yusuf that they kept cutting their fingers over and over again. And that just that one emphasis on one letter in the Qur'an gives you that meaning. This is the power of the Qur'an. Then the last thing I want to talk about today, or before last thing, if we have maybe 5 or 10 minutes, is give examples of the parables of the Qur'an. The parables, the similitudes that are given to us in the Qur'an. For the similitude of the Qur'an by themselves are miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one, they're timeless. These parables that are brought to our attention 1400 years ago are still just as valid, as valuable, as futuristic today as they were 1400 years ago. And they accurately portrays the ideas and the goals behind it. And they understood regardless of cultural or ethnic background. I mean, when I want to give an example, I use things from my environment. I use things that are really pertain to our situation. But here's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending parables that are accepted everywhere by every group of people over time. See, this is the miracles of the similitudes and the parables of the Quran. Let's get some examples. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to give a parable for a shams, for the sun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described it as a siraj. Siraj meaning a lamp, a candle. A candle or a lamp is something that emits heat and light. So here's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said when he's talking about both the moon and the sun. وَجَعَلَ الْقَمَرَ فِيهِنَّ نُورًا وَجَعَلَ الشَّمْسَ سِرَاجًا تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ فِي السَّمَاءِ بُرُوجًا وَجَعَلَ فِيهَا سِرَاجًا وَقَمَرًا مُنِيرًا. When the moon is described, he's described as a light. Because the moon does not generate or emit light, it reflects light. That is, it's an object that is lighting the sky because of reflection of light. So the moon is light, but the sun is a lamp. Lamp, وَجَعَلْنَا سِرَاجًا وَهَاجًا. And we have made a lamp, a candle that وَهَاج, it glows. It glows with heat and light. And then you see these parables of the people that spend their money, but they follow their money with أَذَى and men, with reminder and harm. They are believers. They are believers. They are believers, but they have riya and nifaq. They have the two diseases of showing off, of pretending, and of hypocrisy, wal-iyadu billah. And here's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described these people as, the similitude, and then we will see a parable of the people that actually spend it when they are generous and wanted the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تبطلوا صدقاتكم بالمن والأذى كالذي ينفق ماله رئاء الناس ولا يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فمثله كمثل صفوان عليه تراب فأصابه وابل فتركه صلدا لا يقدرون على شيء مما كسبوا والله لا يهدي القوم الكافرين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the similitude of these people that among the other believers, they are just like believers. Why is that? Because their parable is like a hard, barren rock on which there is little soil. That soil is the mask that they show people around. So when you look at that little land that is really hard to crop, and there is only little soil on top of it, you may think it's fertile. You may think it's a great piece of land. This is a very good place to really plant. But listen what happens when they are tested. When the rain comes, when it falls heavy rain, which leaves it just a bare stone. Bare stone. There is nothing. The truth has been shown. But when you look at the parable of the Muslims or the mu'min, وَمَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ ابْتِغَاءَ مَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ for the pleasure of Allah, وَتَثْبِيتًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ كَمَثَلِ جَنَّةٍ بِرَبْوَةٍ أَصَابَهَا وَابِلٌ فَأَتَتْ أُكُلَهَا ضِعْفَيْنِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يُصِبْهَا وَابِلٌ فَطَلٌ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. It's like a garden of elevated land, fertile. Now we know elevated land that is full, this hilly land, not solid rock, but just old soil land, that's the best land. It's not in a flood zone, right? It's an elevated land. It's not a low land. And that's the best land for agriculture. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, when heavy rains come, then it doubles its harvest. But if even little rain come, it's still good. Even if the mu'min gave a little bit with faith, he's still good. But if he gives more, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doubles the reward. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us about these parables. And we sometimes talk about the timeless parables. This timeless parable of people who try to shield themselves from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To try to protect themselves from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about them. مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ كَمَثَلِ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ اتَّخَذَتْ بَيْتًا وَإِنَّ أَوْهَنَ الْبُيُوتِ لَبَيْتُ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah, the parable of those who take protectors other than Allah is that of a spider who builds to itself a house. But truly, the flimsiest of houses is the spider's house. If they but knew. And this is a fact, this is a scientific fact. The flimsiest of houses is the house of the spider. And it's still out there to challenge. Then another parable. The parables that actually not only show you the acts or things that people do, but tells you about their internal psyche. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you parables to tell you about how people feel. And here is the parable of a person that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them knowledge and given the message of the Islam, the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they rejected it. They don't want it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you how much they're tormented inside, how much doubt and suspicions they have. They cannot rest. They cannot settle down. And I can keep on and on trying to explain to you the psyche, but listen to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala how He gave you this timeless similitude. He said, his similitude is that of a dog. Very ugly similitude. Not the similitude itself, but the person that has been given the example of. If you attack him, he pants. So if they are being chased or run after, they pants. They breathe heavily. Or if you leave them alone, they still pants. They can never rest. They can never really settle because they rejected what can bring settlement to their hearts. And you listen to that miracle. And then another miracle of those, another similitude of those who little bit on the fence. I'm a Muslim, but I really don't want to do that. I don't want to wear hijab. I really like to go to do this. I like to gamble. I like to drink. Whatever. Then they observe some worship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're on the fence. Just a little bit and they fall out. And here's the similitude. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ حَرْفٍ on verge, like they're on the cliff. فَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ خَيْرٌ اطْمَأَنَّ بِهِ if there is not tested, if there is no test come to their faith, they're fine. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ فِتْنَةٌ the first trial, the first tribulation, انْقَلَبَ عَلَىٰ وَجْهِهِ they fall off that cliff. خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ they lose the dunya and they lose the akhirah. ذلك هو الخسران المبين. He كتاب أحكمت آياته ثم فصلت من لدن حكيم خبير. This Quran is so tied together.
I'm gonna leave you, and I'm sorry for taking a little bit more time, but I'm gonna leave you with the final thought. When we read verses, we have always to look and understand that there is a message, there is a theme behind those verses of the Quran. And I want to give you an example that we recite, almost most Muslims recite that every single Friday. And I would just like us to reflect a little bit. Can we see the miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Can we see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ties those together? أُحْكِمَتْ آيَاتُهُ. And that's similar to Surah Al-Kahf. What's in Surah Al-Kahf? Everybody knows Surah Al-Kahf, right? There are four stories in Surah Al-Kahf, basically, right? There is the story of the youth of the cave, those who were persecuted and ran away from persecution. There is the story of the two friends. One of them was wealthy and arrogant, and then he said, مَا أَظُنُّ أَنْ سَبِيلَ هَذِهِ أَبَدًا وَمَا أَظُنُّ السَّاعَةَ قَائِمًا. He denied the hereafter because of the state of wealth that he was in. And the third story is the Musa and the knowledgeable man. Well, the story started when Musa alayhi salam was asked, who's the most knowledgeable person? And Musa said, I. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him to meet somebody who's more knowledgeable than him. And that's the third story. Well, the fourth story is Dhulqarnain, this king that had might and power. وَأَتَيْنَاهُ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ سَبَبًا فَأَتْبَعَ سَبَبًا. He had, of everything, he had technology, he had wealth, he had armies, he had power. مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we gave him everything. فَأَتَيْنَاهُ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ سَبَبًا فَأَتْبَعَ سَبَبًا. So what is the connection there? What is connecting these four stories? What is the theme of this surah? Al-Dhulqarnain was not arrogant. Those youth that were ran away from the cave were not arrogant. Why are these four stories put together? Listen what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about this surah. He said, in Sahih Muslim, مَنْ حَفِظَ عَشْرَ آيَاتٍ مِنْ أَوَّلِ سُورَةِ الْكَهْفِ عُصْنَ مِنَ الدَّجَّالِ. Those who memorize 10 verses of the beginning of the Kahf will be protected from the false Messiah, from the tribulation. Why? Why Surah Al-Kahf protects us from the greatest fitna that will hit earth? Because the four stories that we heard, the stories of fitna, these are the four kinds of fitna that can ever afflict a human being. Look at the explanation of that. The youth of the cave, they were to have the fitna by religious persecution. Many people, if they're persecuted and tortured, they turn away from religion. If there's pressure on them, they subdue the fitna and they leave religion behind. That is one of the things that Dajjal will use. He will torture people, he will kill people. And another thing is wealth, the lure of money and power. That is a fitna. And that is what happened to that man that said, مَا أَظُنُّ السَّاعَةَ قَائِمًا. He was afflicted by this fitna. The third type of fitna is somebody who has knowledge to think that their knowledge to have some arrogance because of the knowledge. وَلِلَّهِ مَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching his prophets. Is do not look at yourself and don't be proud for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. And the fourth is trial by might and power. Many people, when they are given the might and power, they become tyrants. So now it's more clear to us how these four stories tied up together. Why these particular four stories about the two, four types of fitna? And why, if you know Surah Al-Kahf, you will be protected from fitna? With this thought, I've taken too long, and I would like for us, inshallah, to continue. Next weekend, there will be no session because of the fundraiser. The weekend after that will be no session because of the school fundraiser, and then inshallah we will pick up from where we left and we will go into some of the scientific miracles of the Quran inshallah. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Mm-hmm.